good sign or a bad sign?
I'm afraid we have an offer and a counter offer, and I don't think either one has been accepted. If it is relevant to the court, what the nature of it. We had a letter that was offered to us to sign as an apology, which Mr. Shelton did decline. Mr. Shelton has offered an oral apology in court to, on the record, to Mr. Delmichi. That has been declined.
Why is that not accepted? I've got two gentlemen here that don't need to be here. This incident occurred, and I was hoping. Go ahead, Mr. Kirk.
Well, I would say that I'm certainly willing to show you the letter.
Why does it have to be in writing? If Mr. Shelton wants to apologize for his actions, why is on the record not good enough?
Because the nature of this incident, the very humiliation that my client was put through, needs kind of a redressing and a very clear expression of what it is. But an apology that we think comes from Mr. Shelton orally doesn't address and that will not state what my client is seeking. Admission that he was treated improperly, and Mr. Shelton not allowed that.
If the same words are said verbally versus in writing.
It's not the same words, Your Honor.
Okay.
I mean, it's an insincere apology that my client is expecting this oral versus a clear expression. And why can't it be put in writing?
Here we are again.
My client was humiliated in a very public setting.
I got it.
That's what he's asking for, is an opportunity.
And I understand that. I understand. His unwillingness to accept an apology is concerning to me. Except on his terms, that it be done a certain way and in certain words.
It was in writing.
I understand that. I said a certain way. What's the purpose of having it in writing? So he put it on his blog?
Whatever, that's irrelevant, Your Honor. If it was oral, it would go on a blog or in the newspaper. Press is here to report whatever goes on in this whole entire hearing.
I understand.
It's going to be in writing in some fashion. My question is, it's like saying something under oath, Your Honor. I can say anything out on the street corner, but when you put me under oath on that stand, I think in his mind, a man putting your signature on a promissory note means something.
Well, we're not in the promissory note stage here. All I was looking for was two gentlemen who apparently at least have some common political background as Republican dues-paying members that attend apparently weekly or monthly dysfunctional meetings by a bunch of dysfunctional Republicans who can't get along, and it led to what could be criminal behavior, and I had sincerely hoped that because there were no severe injuries other than to his pride or there were emotional injuries or whatever, that perhaps two gentlemen, the perfect resolution of this would be two men who have been to each other's house and been riding in a car together could stand there and talk to one another and say, I'm sorry, never should have happened. And that being two men taking the high road and resolving. I've given every opportunity to do this. I don't know why it can't be done. Can somebody explain to me why this can't be done? Your client in particular?
That opportunity was extended months ago.
Okay, I get that.
It's still...
We're down to the final straw here. This is the 11th hour, I realize. I am concerned I didn't hear a lot of remorse out of your client on the stand about, I'm sorry, I wish I heard you speak of it quite a bit and wished he had done it a different way. I didn't hear a word out of your client about that. That would have been a good opportunity, too. It would have been an excellent opportunity to look Mr. Delmichi in the eye and say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry it happened this way. I got out, you know, I'm sorry.
May I speak?
No, no, not without your client, not without your attorney telling you you can. You know, it just, it's sad. It didn't happen.
And Your Honor, if I could just note, it is a tough situation as the defendant in a warrant application hearing between the balance of resolving the situation and making any admissions that could be aggressively used at a later point. My client has indicated he does wish to make a statement now. If the court would like to hear it, or Mr. Romney would like to hear it,
you know, we warn everybody about their right to remain silent. Unfortunately, a lot of people can't. I don't want to exacerbate things by him making a statement. If you believe it's going to be insincerely received, which I suspect is the feeling over here, is that the apology, if anything, is going to be insincerely given. So we're right back where we started. So at this point, all I can do is issue a warrant for Mr. Shelton's arrest. He will be allowed to turn himself in tomorrow, signature bond, $1,000 signature bond, and that will be up to the solicitor's office to determine the criminal intent involved here. And I'm sorry, Mr. Shelton. I'm sorry, Mr. Delmichi, that y'all are even sitting here. I'm sorry this ever occurred. I'm sorry that it happened the way it did. I'm sorry that someone who lit the fire is not here. They lit the fire and then they left. They're not here. They're not a part of it, other than the brief testimony that we heard back in October. And I'm sorry to have to do that, but this is my obligation. This is why we have these hearings. Legislature wrote these rules that required us to have a hearing prior to the issuance of a warrant, except in four limited circumstances, none of which apply here. And we have had a thorough hearing for over two periods, from October to now. And all of it boils down to what was on the video. What was on the video is sufficient for me to issue a warrant for Mr. Shelton's arrest. And I'm sorry I got to do it, in a way. I'm sorry you got to this point, sir. I'm sorry that you are so insistent, sir, that we handle this matter. I wish it could have been handled a different way by everybody. It never should have happened, but it should have been resolved by two men standing there face to face, talking to each other and saying, Tony, gosh, I'm sorry, you know, I'm sorry I did that. It just got out of hand, and I apologize, and two men could have moved on. There's no big injuries to you, sir. I mean, no physical injuries. I know that you're upset about it. Got a right to be, but the person who got it started, of course, is not part of this criminal action, but I wish there had been a different outcome by counsel and the parties, but perfect solution would perhaps have been the two gentlemen sitting in the conference room face-to-face talking to one another, maybe without counsel, but that probably would have been the best recommendation for Ms. Bernard to turn the client loose. But could have happened a long time ago. Could have happened that night. Could have happened back in July when everybody calmed down. Mr. Anderson got everybody apart. That would have been a great time to resolve it. But there may be some undercurrents here that I'm not getting as far as whether or not there were attempts to squash free speech. The only free speech I heard was point of order, point of order. You're out of order. That's all I was hearing speaking at that moment. So I don't feel that this rises to some great level of violations of free speech or anything like that. It was a simple misdemeanor criminal situation that never should have happened, but it did. It's on video for all the world to see, and I guess everybody had seen it but me until tonight, so now I've seen it. All right, you may turn yourself in tomorrow, sir. You'll be allowed to sign your own bond, and book your process in and out tomorrow after 10 a.m.
Thank you, Your Honor. And I would actually ask, I do understand that I think there's a doctor's appointment and something else. Would it be possible to do a Wednesday turn in?
He can turn in Wednesday. That's perfectly acceptable.
Thank you.
Not a flight risk. He's not a risk to reoffend. He's not, this case never should have happened. That's all I can say. Thank you all.